founder paradox. Of the six people who start people, four had built bombs in high school. Five were just 23 years old or younger. Four of us had been born outside the United States. Three had escaped here from communist countries. Yu Pan from China, Luke Nusik from Poland, and Max Levchin from Soviet Ukraine. Building bombs were not what kids normally did in those countries at that time. The six of us could have been seen as eccentric. My first hour conversation with Luke was about how he had just signed up for Chronix to be frozen up, that in hope of medical resurrection. Max claimed to be without a country and proud of it. His family was put into diplomatic limbo when the USSR collapsed while they were escaping to the US. Russ Simmons had escaped from a Taylor Park to the top math and science magnet school in Illinois. Only Ken Howery fit the stereotype of a privileged American childhood. He was PayPal Soul Eagle Scott, but Kenny Pierre thought he was crazy to join the rest of us and make us 1/3 of the salary he had been offered by a big bank. So even he wasn't entirely normal. The people team in 1999. After all, founders usually pupil, or do we just tend to remember and exaggerate whether is most unusual about them? More important, which personal traits actually matter in a founder? This chapter is about why it's more powerful but at the same time more dangerous for a company to be led by a distinctive individual instead of an interchangeable manager. The difference engine. Some people are strong, some are weak, some are geniuses, some are dullards, but most people are in the middle plot where everyone falls, and you will see a bell curve, normal distribution of traits. We can see weak, nerd, idiot, servant, disagreeable, outsider, average, strong, athlete, polymath, charismatic, insider, rich, hero, famous. Since so many founders seems to have extreme traits, you might guess what a plot showing only founder traits would have fatter trails with more people at either end. Fat tail distribution. Frequency. Weak, nerd, average, strong, athlete. But that doesn't capture the strangest thing about founders. Normally, we expect opposite traits to be mutually exclusive. A normal person can be both rich and poor at the same time, for instance. But it happens all the time to founders. Startup CEOs can be cash poor, but millionaires on paper. They may oscillate between sullen jerkiness and appealing charisma. Almost all successful entrepreneurs are simultaneously insider and outsider, but when they do succeed, they attract both fame and infamy. When you plot them out, founder's trait appears to follow an inverse normal distribution. The founder distribution frequency. Average. Where does this average and extreme combination of traits come from? They could be present from birth, nature, or acquired from an individual environment, nurture, but perhaps founders aren't really as extreme as they appear. Might they strategically exaggerate certain qualities, or is it possibly that everyone else exaggerates them? All of these effects can be present at the same time, and whenever present, they powerfully reinforce each other. The cycle usually starts with usual pupil and ends with them acting and seeming even more usual. Actual, different, other exaggerate, develop extreme traits, they exaggerate. electorate. As an example, take Sir Richard Branson, the billionaire founder of the Virgin Group. He could be described as a natural entrepreneur. Branson started his first business at the age 16, and at just 22, he founded Virgin Records. But other aspects of his renown, the trademark lined meme hairstyle, for example, are less natural. One suspect he wasn't born with that exact look, as Branson has cultivated his other extreme traits. It's kiteboarding with naked supermodel appears turned just a guy having fun. Both the media has eagerly enthroned him. Branson is the Virgin King, the undisputed king of PR, the king of branding, the king of the desert and space. When Virgin Atlantic Airways began serving passenger drinks with ice cubes shaped like Branson's face, he became the ice king. Is Branson just a normal businessman who happens to be lionized by the media with the help of a good PR team, or is he himself a born branding genius rightly singled out by the journalists? He is so good at manipulating, it's hard to tell. Maybe he's both. Another example is Sean Parker, who started out with the ultimate outsider status. Criminal Sean was a careful hacker in high school, but his father decided that Sean was spending too much time on the computer for 16 years old. So one day he took away Sean's keyboard mid-hack. Sean couldn't log out. The FBI noticed. Soon federal agents were placing him under arrest. Sean got off easy since he was a minor. If anything, the opposite emboldened him. 3 years later, he co-founded Napster, the peer-to-peer file sharing service, amassed 10 million users in its first year, making it one of the fastest growing businesses of all time. But the record company sued, and a federal judge ordered it shut down 20 months after opening. After a whirlwind period at the center, Sean was back to being an outsider again. Then came Facebook. Sean met Mark Zuckerberg in 2004, helped negotiate Facebook's first funding, and became the company founding president. He had to step down in 2005 amid allegations of drug use, but his only enhanced his notoriety. Ever since Justin Timberlake portrayed him in The Social Network, Sean has been perceived as one of the coolest people in America. JT is still more famous, but when he visits Silicon Valley, people ask if he's Sean Parker. The most famous people in the world are founders too. Instead of a company ever celebrating, founds and cultivates a personal brand. Lady Gaga, for example, became one of the most influential living people. But is she even a real person? Her real name isn't secret, but almost no one knows or cares what it is. She wears costumes so bizarre as to put any other wearer at risk or of an involuntary citric hold. Gaga would have you believe that she was born this way. The title of both her second album and its lead track, But No One Is Born, looking like a zombie with horns coming out of her head. Gaga must therefore be a self-manufactured myth. Then again, what kind of person would do this to herself? Certainly nobody normal. So perhaps Gaga really was born that way. Where kings come from. Extreme founder figures are not new in human affair. Classical methodology is full of them. Oedipus is the paradigmatic insider-outsider. He was abandoned as an infant and ended up in a foreign land, but he was a brilliant king and smart enough to solve the riddle of the Sphinx. Remove Paulus and Remus were born of royal blood and abandoned as orphans when they discovered their pedigree, they decided to found a city, but they couldn't agree on where to put it. When Remus crossed the boundary that Romulus had decided was the age of Rome, Romulus killed him, declaring, "So perish everyone that shall hereafter leap over my wall, lawmaker and lawbreaker, criminal, outlaw, and king who defined Rome." Romulus was a self-contradictory insider, outsider. Normal people aren't like Oedipus or Romulus, whatever those individuals were actually like in life. The methodologist version of them remember only the extreme. But why was it so important for archaic cultures to remember extraordinary people? The famous and infamous have always served as vessel for public sentiment. They are praised amid prosperity and blamed for misfortune. Primitive society faced one fundamental problem above all. They would be torn apart by conflict if they didn't have a way to stop it. So whenever Pelagius disaster or violent revelries threatened the peace, it was beneficial for the society to place the entire blame on a single person, someone everybody could agree on, a scapegoat. Who makes an effective scapegoat? Like founders, scapegoats are extreme and contradictory figures. On the one hand, a scapegoat is necessarily weak. He is powerless to stop his own victimization. On the other hand, as the one who can diffuse conflict by taking the blame, he is the most powerful member of the community. Before execution, scapegoats were often worshipped like deities. The Aztec considered their victims to be earthly form of the gods to whom they were sacrificed. You could be dressed in fine clothes and feast royally until your brief reign ended and they cut your heart out. These are the roots of monarchy. Every king was a living god and every god is a murdered king. Perhaps every modern king is just a scapegoat who has managed to delay his own execution. American royalty. Celebrities are supposed American royalty. We even grant titles to our favorite performers. Elvis Presley was a king of rock. Michael Jackson was a king of pop. Michael Jackson was a king of pop. Britney Spears was the pop princess. Until they weren't, Elvis self-destructed in the 70s and died alone, overweight, sitting on his toilet. Today, his impersonators are fat and sketchy, not lean and cool. Michael Jackson went from beloved child star to an erratic, physically repulsive, drug-addicted shell of his former self. The world revealed in the detail of his trails. Britney's story is the most dramatic of all. We created her from nothing, elevating her to superstardom as a teenager, but then everything fell off the track. Witness the shave head, the over and under eating scandal, and the highly publicized court case to take away her children. Was she always a little bit crazy? Did the publicity just get to her, or did she do it all to get more? For more fallen star that bring resurrection, so many popular musicians have died at the age of 27. Janis Joplin, Jimmy Hendrix, Jimmy Morrison, and Kurt Cobain, for example. This set has become immortalized as the 27 Club. Before she joined the club in 2011, Amy Winehouse sang, "They tried to make me go to rehab, but I said no, no, no. Maybe your hub seems too unattractive because it blocks the path to immortality. Perhaps the only way to be rock god forever is to die an early death. We alternatively worship and despise technology founders just as we do celebrities. Howard Hughes' arc from fame to pity is the most dramatic of any 20th century tech founder. He was born wealthy, but he was always more interested in engineering than luxury. He built Hudson's first radio transmitter at the age of 11. The year after that, he built the city's first motorcycle. By age 30, he made nine commercially successful movies at the time when Hollywood was on the technological frontier. But Hughes was even more famous for his parallel career in aviation. He designed planes, produced them, and piloted them himself. Hughes set world records for top air speed, fastest transcontinental flight, and fastest flight around the world. Hughes was obsessed with flying higher than everyone else. He liked to remind people that he was a mere mortal, not a Greek god, something that mortals say only when they want to invite comparison to gods. Hughes was a man to whom you cannot apply the same standard as you can do to you and me. His lawyer once argued in federal court, Hughes paid the lawyer to say that, but according to the New York Times, there was no dispute on this point from judge or jury. When Hughes was awarded the Congressional Gold Medal in 1939 for his achievement in aviation, he didn't even show up to claim it. Years later, President Truman found it in the White House and mailed it to him. The beginning of Hughes' end came in 1946 when he suffered his third and worst plane crash. Had he died then, he would have been remembered forever as one of the most dashing and successful Americans of all time. But he survived barely. He became obsessive compulsive, addicted to painkillers, and withdraw from the public to spend last 30 years of his life in self-imposed solitary confinement. Hughes had always acted a little crazy on the theory that fewer people would want to bother a crazy person, but when his crazy act turned into a crazy life, he became an object of pity as much as I. More recently, Bill Gates has shown how highly visible success can attract highly focused attack. Gates embodied the founder archetype. He was simultaneously an awkward and nerdy college dropout outsider, the world's wealthiest insider. Did he choose his geeky eyeglasses strategically to build up a distinctive persona? Or in his incurable nerdiness, did he geek glasses choose him? It's hard to know, but his dominance was undeniable. Microsoft Windows claimed a 90% share of the market for operating system in 2000. That year, Peter Jennings could plausibly ask, who is more important in the world today, Bill Clinton or Bill Gates? I don't know. It is a good question. The U.S. Department of Justice didn't limit itself to rhetorical questions. They opened an investigation and sued Microsoft for anti-competitive conduct. In June 2000, a court ordered that Microsoft be broken apart. Gates had stepped down as CEO of Microsoft 6 months earlier, having been forced to spend most of his time responding to legal threats instead of building new technology. A court of appeals letter overturned the breakup order, and Microsoft reached a settlement with the government in 2001. But by then, Gates' enemies had already deprived his company of full engagement of its founder, and Microsoft entered an era of relative stagnation. Today, Gates is better known as a philanthropist than a technologist. written of the king. Just as the legal attack on Microsoft was ending Bill Gates' dominance, Steve Jobs' return to Apple demonstrated the irreplaceable value of company founder. In some ways, Steve Jobs and Bill Gates were opposite. Jobs was an artist, preferred closed system, and spent his time thinking about great projects above all else. Gates was a businessman, kept his project open, and wanted to run the world. But both were insider-outsider, and both pushed the companies they started to achieve that nobody else would have been able to match. A college dropout who walked around barefoot and refused to shower, Jobs was also the insider of his own personality cult. He could act charismatic or crazy, perhaps according to his mood or perhaps according to his calculation. It's hard to believe that such weird practices as Apple only died weren't part of a larger strategy, but all his eccentricity backfired on him in 1985. Apple's board effectively kicked Jobs out of his own company when he clashed with the professional CEO brought in to provide adult supervision. Jobs returns to Apple 12 years later show how the most important task in business, the creation of new value, cannot be reduced to a formula and applied by professionals. When he was hired as interim CEO of Apple in 1997, the impeccable credentialed executive who preceded him had steered the company nearly to bankruptcy that year. Michael Dell famously said of Apple, "What would I do? I shut it down and give the money back to the shareholder." Instead, Jobs introduced the iPod 2001, the iPhone 2007, and iPad 2010 before he had to resign in 2011 because of the poor health. By the following year, Apple was single most valuable company in the world. Apple value crucially depended on the singular version of a particular person. This hint at the strange way in which the companies that create new technology often resemble feudal monarchies rather than organizations that are supposedly more modern. A unique founder can make authoritative decisions, inspire strong personal loyalty, and plan ahead for decades. Paradoxically, impersonal bureaucracies staffed by trained professionals can last longer than any lifetime, but they usually act with short time horizon. The lesson for business is that we need founders. If anything, we should be more tolerant of founder who seems strange or extreme. We need unusual individuals to lead companies beyond mere incrementalism. The lesson for founder is that individual prominence and adulation can never be enjoyed except on the condition that it may be exchanged for individual notoriety and demonization at any moment, so be careful. Above all, don't overestimate your own power as an individual. Founders are important not because they are only ones whose work has value, but rather because a great founder can bring out the best work from everybody at his company. That we need individual founders in all their peculiarity does not mean that we are called to worship an Randian prime mover who claims to be independent of everybody around them. In this respect, Rand was a merely half-great writer. Her Williams were real, but her heroes were fake. There is no gulch. There is no secession from society. To believe yourself invested with divine self-sufficiency is not the mark of a strong individual, but of a person who has mistaken the crowd worship or jeering for the truth. The individual, but of a person who has mistaken the crowd worship or jeering for the truth, the single greatest danger for a founder is to become so certain of his own myth that he loses his mind. But an equally insidious danger for every business is to lose all sense of myth and mistake this enhancement for wisdom. Conclusion: stagnation or singularity. If even the most far-sighted founder cannot plan beyond the next 20 to 30 years, is there anything to say about the very distant future? We don't know anything specific, but we can make out the broad contour. Philosopher Nick Bostrom described four possible patterns for the future of humanity. The ancients saw all of history as a never-ending alternation between prosperity and ruin. Only recently have planned dare to hope that we might permanently escape misfortune, and it is still possible to wonder whether the stability we take for granted will last. Recurrent collapse. Progress. However, we usually suppress our doubts. Conventionally, wisdom seems to assume instead that the whole world will converge towards a plateau of development similar to the life of the richest countries today. In this scenario, the future will look a lot like the present. Plateau progress. Given the interconnected geography to the contemporary world and the unprecedented destructive power of modern weaponry, it's hard not to ask whether a large-scale social disaster could be contained where to occur. This is what fuel our fear of the third possible scenario, a collapse so devastating that we won't survive it. Extinction progress. The last of the four possibility and the hardest one to imagine: accelerating take off towards a much better future. The end result of such breakthrough could take a number of forms, but any one of them would be so different from the present as to defy description. Take off progress. Which of the four will it be? Recurrent collapse seems unlikely. The knowledge underlying civilization is so widespread today that complete annihilation would be more probable than a long period of darkness followed by recovery. However, in case of extinction, there is no human future of any kind to consider. If we define the future as a time that looks different from the present, then most people aren't expecting any future at all. Instead, they expect coming decades to bring more globalization, convergence, and sameness. In this scenario, poorer countries will catch up to richer countries, and the world as a whole will reach an economic plateau. But even if a truly globalized plateau were possible, could it last? In the best case, economic competition would be more intense than ever before for every single person and firm on the planet. However, when you add competition to consume scarce resources, it's hard to see how a global plateau could last indefinitely. Without new technologies to relieve competitively pressure, stagnation is likely to erupt into conflict. In case of conflict on a global scale, stagnation collapses into extinction. That leaves the fourth scenario, in which we create new technologies to make a much better future. The most dramatic version of this outcome is called the singularity, an attempt to name the imagined result of new technologies so powerful as to transcend the current limit of our understanding. Ray Kurzweil, the best known singularitarian, start from Murray's law, and traces exponential growth trends in dozens of fields, confidently projecting a future of superhuman artificial intelligence. According to Kurzweil, the singularity is near, it is inevitable, and all we have to do is prepare ourselves to accept it. But no matter how many trends can be traced, the future won't happen on its own. What the singularity would look like matter less than the stark choice we face today between the two most likely scenarios, nothing or something. It's up to us. We cannot take for granted that the future will be better, and that means we need to work to create it today. Whether we achieve the singularity on a cosmic scale is perhaps less important than whether we seize the unique opportunities we have to do new things in our own working life. Everything important to us, the universe, the planet, the country, your company, your life, and this very movement is singular. Our task today is to find singular ways to create the new things that will make the future not just different but better, to go from zero to one. The essential first step is to think for yourself. Only by seeing our world anew, as fresh and as strange as it was the ancient who saw it first, we can both recreate it and preserve it for the future. Acknowledge Jim Caltrader for helping to think this book through. Rob Morris, Scott Mullen, Michael Solana for co-creating the Stanford class for which we are started. Chris Paris Limp, Tina Constable, David Brake, Talia Cron, and Jeremia Hall of skillfully guiding us to publication. Everyone to Tail Capital Founder Fund, Material and the Tail Foundation for working hard and smart onwards. Illustration of credits. The illustration in the book were drawn by the Matt Buck based on the following images. About the author. Peter Thiel is an entrepreneur and investor. He started PayPal in 1998, led to as CEO, and took it public in 2012. Defining a new era of fast and secure online commerce, in 2004, he made the first outside investment in Facebook, where he served as a director. The same year, he launched Palantir Technologies, a software company that harnesses computer to empower human analysis in fields like national security and global finance. He has provided early funding for LinkedIn, Yelp, and dozens of successful technical startups, many run by former colleagues who have been dubbed the PayPal Mafia. He has a partner at Founders Fund, a Silicon Valley venture capital firm that has funded companies like SpaceX and Airbnb. He started the Thiel Fellowship, which ignited a national debate by encouraging young people to put learning before schooling. And he led the Thiel Foundation, which worked to advance technological progress and long-term thinking about the future. Black Masters was a student at Stanford Law School in 2012 when his detailed notes on Peter Thiel, Computer Science 183 startup, became an internet sensation. He went on to co-founded Judicata, a legal research technological startup.